Hi, everybody. Everybody hear me fine? Thanks so much for coming to this golf town hall presented by the golf committee. But what we really are trying to do is introduce you to the Troon, our Troon people, because you haven't had that opportunity. First off, I'm Lee Lexell. I'm the golf committee chair, and our Troon people that we're going to have here, we have Matt Malloy, vice president of, let me get it right, of operations for Troon. We have David Stout, and David is the regional agronomist for Troon. We have our Mike Carpy, our dog, our director of golf here at Saddlebrook. And we have Dan Liniger from the board. Another dog, different kind of dog, who is our board vice president, and he is the liaison to our golf committee, to the board. And this was kind of his idea to get it out there. You're going to hear quite a bit today. Some of the things that we wanted as the golf committee, we wanted to get things out in the public so that you know what's going on. And one of the things that I'm real happy about, you'll get to hear, is our proposed rate sheet that we're going to have. So you're going to see that before it turns into a rate sheet. First of all, they wanted me to do a little history of golf management here at HOA 2. But I was going to start with a little history of my golf here at HOA, because I think it's interesting. You see what you think. Denise and I started looking around for a place to retire in about 2010, well before our retirement time. We looked all over the Southwest. We looked in Florida. We were planning on going to Texas and Carolina, but we kept ending up in Tucson. We were up in Scottsdale and stuff like that, but we loved Tucson. And by about 2015, we had decided we were going to move to Tucson. We looked around. We never got to look at Saddlebrook, surprisingly, but we were up at the ranch. And in 2015, we were all set to move to the ranch. As a matter of fact, we were going to put money down on a house in, I think it was June of 2015. But, you know, you start to get a little buyer's remorse and questioning. So I said to Denise, I go, is this really what we want? I don't love that golf course. And she goes, oh, it's a good enough golf course. You get to play every day. I go, you're right. But don't you think I should go see what that Saddlebrook golf course looks like? And she says, well, yeah, let's try. So the next morning, fortuitously, I was able to get a tee time on the preserve at 7 a.m. So it's a June 7 a.m. We show up on the first tee, and it's drop-dead gorgeous as a June 7 a.m. is always in Tucson. There's no dew, you know. I'm expecting to have wet shoes and all that, being a northerner. We go out and play, and we're still in rye. The course is in spectacular condition. We're loving it. I just go, boy, is this nice. We get to the sixth tee box, you know, that little box canyon, and Denise looks at me and says, new plan. We're moving to Saddlebrook. We called the realtor. About 30 houses later, so golf is important to this community. You know, it is the only reason that we are here. I mean, she loves pickleball, we love the community, but golf is what brought us here, and it was the best decision of our lives. So let's talk about the HOA 2 golf so far. In 1997, Mountain View was built. In 2004, the preserve was built. Of course, Robeson ran those until transition in 2018. The only component that was really altered in all of those years was in 2015, when Robeson did the greens at Mountain View, regrassed the greens at Mountain View. So we took over in 2018, and we ran it ourselves through 2022. And in 2022, that board at that time decided to hire a golf management company. They looked at a few and they opted for, at that time, now you got to get your scorecards ready, they opted for Club Corp. And we hired Club Corp to manage our golf operations. Club Corp quickly changed its name to Invited, same company, just a little different operation, and continued to manage us. Then in 2023, Invited sold their part of their portfolio, which included us, to the Troon Corporation, and Troon began to manage us. So that's where we are today with Troon managing our operations. We have our Troon people here working with us. So I wanted you guys to get to know our Troon operations. So I'm going to start with Matt Malloy and let him tell you about that.
Good afternoon, everyone. As Lee said, my name is Matt Malloy. I have been with Troon. Well, I was with OB Sports for another management company for 14 years as a general manager. I've been a PGA member for just over 25 years. I got a great little pin after 25 years. And then in 2019, Troon bought OB Sports, and I've been with them ever since.
Hey, Matt.
Yes, sir.
You're a good-looking guy. Why don't you stand down where there's a
little light? Hey, you can see me. A little bit more about me. I'm from New York, so for those football fans out there, you know it's going to be a tough season for me, so be nice to me if you see me. The Giants are absolutely terrible this year. But we want to take you through some slides and presentation on our company. I want to start with a video. Mike's a great golf professional, but maybe not IT. Here, let me do this.
We're in the hospitality business.
Here we go.
Golf only exists because it's fun.
What is special about golf is the relationships.
That joy of hitting that great shot or making that great putt or being out there with your family, your friends, so many different chances and opportunities are presented from the game of golf.
It all comes back to me to the fun element of this. You can't expect someone to be with you 4 hours, spend a lot of money, unless you do things right. Whether it be the agronomic conditions, whether it be the food and beverage offerings, whether it be putting them with people they feel comfortable with, we're in the hospitality business. So it's our job to take care of people and make sure that they have a great day.
Troon is brilliant. It's always first-class experiences. Courses that they run, they want it to be as good as possible, and it makes a big difference for the experience.
It's really cool having a partner in Troon that does so much for the game of golf, top to bottom, across the board, whether it's daily fee player, your private club player, they're able to provide just an awesome experience.
Our story is that we present the opportunity to execute at a high level of hospitality and be involved with the club in a way that allows them to continue to control the club's identity and the way that the club presents itself to its members, but get out of the day-to-day management. What's unique about Troon is we customize our approach to achieve success with our partners.
I think the toughest part for board members is to admit what they don't know. There's nothing wrong with bringing in someone that knows the industry, that knows a little bit more about golf operations, how to manage it, than you do.
Best practices in any business, the way you achieve that, the way that you find that, is to go to experts.
You know, as coaches, we don't get to get on the field anymore, but we've got to design the plan and then coach, counsel, and train individuals to get it done. By bringing Troon in, they already had some great recommendations and suggestions for us, and it did allow us to accelerate the improvement in our courses and get us to where we're at today. It's not by accident, it's by design.
What we've been able to do is to take the massive amount of data that we have across a number of different platforms and allow the general managers to make real-time decisions based on what's happening in their business.
We're able to go out and find specifically what an individual owner wants. We know each one of them have a different desire. It may be to add value to their homes. It may be to put heads on beds in a resort. It may be to offer a great service level and break even. It may be to make a profit. But we can tailor-made our services to make sure anyone gets what they're looking for.
For Troon, success and engagement looks like a collaborative partnership.
When you have a choice to select a management company, why wouldn't you select Troon? You're selecting the best of the best. You know the quality you're getting. You know the experience you're getting. There's nobody better.
So I guess one of the things I take away from that video is we're here to make Saddlebrook, Mountain View, and the preserve the star, right? We're here to support the efforts. So just to give you some background, you know, Troon was founded over 30 years ago by Dana Garmany, who's also a PGA professional. Next slide. So we have 900 plus locations, 200 semi-private, private clubs. We have a huge, huge portfolio. Where that might scare some people is that you get lost in the shuffle and you don't, because you have guys like myself and David at the corporate office, and I'll run through the corporate support staff here in a second to show you. Next slide. So it was founded up in Scottsdale. True North was the start of the company. And again, it was hospitality management formed. So not just golf, but really a hospitality company. So you can see the timelines. I won't read through them all. It grew into the early 2000s as golf was booming. Housing boom in the early 2000s. Fast forward to 2014. Troon began to acquire other companies. Honors Golf is a management company in the Southeast. I think it was 14 clubs at that time. Next year, Caddymaster. Caddymaster is a caddy company. We're at Pebble Beach, Whistling Straits, Pinehurst, all great resorts, and that's just a Caddymaster business that's within Troon. And then again, True Club Solutions was formed. We bought Cliff Drysdale Tennis. Any tennis players in the room? Pickleball? I played college tennis. I haven't converted to pickleball yet, but I think I'm getting there. And as I mentioned, in 2019, they bought OB Sports. OB Sports at the time was 60 clubs. Two years later, Indigo Golf, which used to be Billy Casper Golf. Some of you might be familiar with that. They were just north of 150 clubs. And then some other additions to the company over the last couple years. And that brings us to today. So as mentioned, here are the different brands within Troon. Similar to a Marriott model or Hilton, where they have different brands of their hotels. And then all the other companies within Troon. So this is really where I, you know, as a general manager for a management company, I always felt like I had the best Rolodex. Everyone remember the Rolodex? Anyone? Am I dating myself? I always had the best Rolodex in the business because, different than a single course operator, I had this this wealth of knowledge and experience that I could call on at any time. And if they didn't know the answer, they knew where to find it. And that's really what Troon brings and what David and myself bring to Saddle Rock. So here are all the resources from food and beverage, sales and marketing, golf instruction, racket sports, you know, from resurfacing companies with pickleball growing like it is. We partnered with a pickleball, a court resurfacing company. So all these great resources we have at our fingertips, and thus at your fingertips. So as mentioned, here's the corporate support team for Mountain View, the Preserve, and Saddlebrook 2. Myself, David Stout, who's Director of Science and Agronomy. He's a golf course superintendent. David's also been a general manager, has years and years of experience on both sides of the business, and that's a great asset to have. Steve Outlaw is a PGA member as well. He's the Director of Sales and Marketing, works with Mike hand-in-hand in our efforts on the sales and marketing side. Tiffany Sloan, retail manager. Daniel Gonzalez is our HR partner, business partner who handles all the HR issues. We have our shared accountant and our payroll specialist. So because of the size of Troon, we're able to leverage that size and get national accounts where we can pass those savings on to all of our clubs. So from Callaway rental clubs, Callaway range balls, all their apparel, club car, Toro equipment, all these items, they can add up real quick, especially when you're talking about golf course maintenance equipment. Next. And then another one is the sales and marketing piece. And you can go to this is a private club. And I have both these slides up because Saddlebrook 2 falls kind of in the middle of the private club and the daily fee. Next slide. And resort facilities. Anyone know where that is by any chance? Anyone, people from Colorado? You know what the name of it is? Bear Dance. I lived in Colorado for a little while, and the greens were so severe when it was built, we called it Unfair Dance. Those greens have been softened, but this bunker sure is a signature of their golf course. Go back. Sorry. Can you go back? Well, that's fine. The sales and marketing piece, obviously, it's a huge piece of golf operations. There's a lot of golf courses. Anyone know how many golf courses in the country? Anyone up here? Mike, you don't know? Just over like 14,500 courses in the country. It's a lot of competition. So, and certainly in the Tucson market, there's a lot of competition. So we use our expertise, we use examples from other clubs throughout the country on what works, what doesn't, what programs work, what operational metrics can work, from tee time dynamic pricing, which is a huge movement within the golf space. Dynamic pricing is no different than hotels, airlines, and rental cars. We have a fixed amount of inventory every day to sell, and we want to sell it at the maximum price. And so with hotels, you know that if there's one room left, you're going to pay a lot. And so golf as an industry has moved in that direction over the last 20 years. You can go to the next slide. So Troon Advantage, this is access to the participating courses in the Troon network for a reduced price, for a reduced green fees. And I think right now there's just over 200 courses that participate in Troon Advantage. You all the annual pass holders have access to that. So whether you're going to Hawaii, you're going to Abu Dhabi, maybe you don't go that far, but certainly Hawaii or California, Florida, there's some great courses there we work with. So certainly something to take advantage of. Troon.com, obviously we feature all the courses that we work with on that site. Saddlebrook 2, you can see there. Millions and millions of views on Troon.com. Five million page views, and just over 1.5 million users. Public relations, you can see Mr. Carpy up there in his blazer with his PJ emblem. Very, very proud day. We're very proud of Mike and what he's done and how he's transitioned from his previous role into his new role. We're really excited to support him and his efforts here. We did a press release on the completion of the Mountain View Golf Course renovation. And our distribution is just north of 2.5 million for our email database. We launched a new website for the Saddlebrook 2 golf courses, Mountain View and Preserve. So much cleaner look, more visual, less words. People don't read websites anymore. It's all visual. And then obviously social media. Everyone have a Twitter handle in here? No? Instagram? All right. Facebook? Okay. No, but this is a huge piece of marketing right now. From Facebook ads to Instagram posts to the reels of videos, that's something that we're ramping up as we head into the season this year. The Facebook ads are an amazing tool because people have offered so much information about themselves that can be very, very targeted. From your likes, dislikes, where you live, how much you make, all those types of things. We have our Play Troon calendar. So we support the efforts here with Patriot Golf, as Mike just did, Women's Golf Month, Bring Your Daughter to the Golf Course, Troon Fit. There's all these programs that you'll start to see as the season gets rolling. And here's a snapshot of some of the marketing, the efforts through our partner in Golf Now and NBC Sports, who owns Golf Now, just in driving outside play, specifically, mostly on the Preserve, while Mountain View was closed. But this is just over the last three months. So we'll continue to push this. We'll continue to supplement the revenue from annual pass holders and residents with outside play without affecting availability. And just some more of the programs that I mentioned for our daily fee and resort courses, Troon Family Golf Month, I mentioned Women's Golf Month, and Troon Rewards. And so Troon Rewards is a loyalty program that everyone can participate in, and you'll earn points for every dollar you spend, and you can use those points towards free rounds of golf here or any of our participating courses. So we'll be launching this in late October, along with a new golf program. Any questions for me, other than the Giants? Yankees are doing well, I think. Yes, sir.
Mets are doing good too.
I'm sorry?
Mets.
Well, you can't like both of them. You like you're up in New York. You got to choose sides. You can't like the Yankees and the Mets.
I don't.
No, the Mets are better than the Yankees. I'm just hoping Judge breaks the record again this year. So, but I'll tell you, I'm excited to see what Mountain View is going to look like in Overseed. I think it's going to be a sneaky, sneaky, awesome golf course, and people will be fighting to come and play it. I'm excited about this facility. It's one of the most well-kept, cleanest, upkept facility that I've been to, that I manage. I work with 15 other clubs, and I'm blown away by it, from the roads to the clubhouse to the restaurants. So I'm really impressed with where it is today. Yes, sir. No. So we work with that. We can set all those metrics. We maintain price integrity. And the goal is actually to drive the rate higher. And the rate is higher for public as we look at last year. And we'll look to continue that. Obviously, with the renovation of Mountain View, that's going to be one of our goals, to make sure we're maximizing that and getting the rates and keeping the integrity of the resident rate versus the public rate. And also access. Someone else had a question up top, maybe? Sir?
Can I make a comment real quick? Matt, I had to be the mom here, unfortunately.
Sorry. I have one.
But we are videoing this presentation.
Yes.
And the only way that people at home can hear your question, which is really hopefully is a great question, is through a microphone. And it's unfortunate, so I got to kind of ask, if you do want to have a question, which is wonderful, you got to kind of come down and make sure it goes through the system, because people at home can only then listen to what the response is,
okay,
and they didn't know the context of what you were trying to ask. Sure. So sorry about that, kind of a rule of the road, but I wanted to make sure we did that to be consistent with the other meetings we hold here. So thank you. Come on down.
It was at the end too.
Yeah, same thing.
Hear me?
Justin. Maybe try this one.
Thank you. So I don't know if this meets your criteria of great question or not, but and hopefully I didn't forget it on the way down, but not to get into the weeds, do you have any thoughts or metrics on course usage versus rates and getting that on outside now and drawing in traffic with that? If you understand my question,
yeah,
am I clear?
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's something that we look at constantly. We look at our occupancy, we look at our rate. Obviously, you know, Business 101 tells us that if your occupancy is very high, we need to change our rate.
Yeah.
But golf is also very different because it's also based on time of day and day of the week. So we look at all those segments and even segments throughout the day. So from 8 to 10 is a different segment, right. 10 to 12, and then afternoon twilight. Those are all different segments that we look at as we look at rate. So it's a great question, and it's something that I think as a company as big as we are, we're able to have all that data at all different areas throughout the country, all different types of clubs. But specifically, we look solely at the activity here.
And quick follow-up, are you able to see a trend on whether or not usage is picking up and we're filling the holes in that regard?
Well, usage in general is slightly down in Arizona, the last report I saw. But the good news is rate is up. And so overall revenue is up. So one of the benefits, golf was a huge benefactor of COVID, unfortunately, or fortunately.
Yeah.
And so we're still seeing that. We did expect as an industry there would be more of a dip, but there hasn't been. There was a slight dip after the COVID rush, and it's really maintained a plateau from there. Yeah, we do look at that here, and it's something we will continue. We're breaking out rounds now a little bit deeper so we can analyze where, you know, what time of day, who's playing, what rate, and what category those people are coming from. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your questions.
Thank you.
Those mics are working now. You're good at
Thanks, Rick.
All right. I am going to introduce Mike Carpy. Do we have your presentation? He is the, as they mentioned, he is the new dog, the new director of golf operations, and I'll turn it over to Mike.
Thanks, Matt. Well, first of all, thanks for everybody for coming out. I'm not used to standing on a stage and talking to you. It's usually starting to talk about events and getting people on the golf course and playing fast enough to make sure lunch is ready. And so I just wanted to real quick go over our new organizational chart. This was approved by the board not too long ago. The big thing that you see there is we're going to have a head professional and director of agronomy, which we'll talk about in just a second. But previously, they had been kind of on an equal level. There hadn't been one person to come back to answer to. So moving forward, I'm in that role. I don't want to talk about me. I want to be able to talk about what our operations team and what our golf course maintenance teams are going to do. So as you can see, Mark Soto, which we'll talk about him in just a minute, new director of agronomy, and then Alex McAllister is your superintendent at Mountain View, and J.R. Keyes is up at the preserve. Both those gentlemen have done a wonderful job here in the last little bit, making sure that our golf courses are fantastic, and it's only the beginning, right? We're going to continue this trend. Wayne Clark, as you probably saw, is our new head golf professional. He's going to start right around October 1st. Talk about him in a minute. And then we're still looking for an assistant golf professional for each golf course. So we're going through resumes, Wayne and I are. I asked Wayne, I said, I know you haven't started yet, but could you look at some of these resumes? I said, I know you're not on the clock. He goes, you should know by now, I'm not an on-the-clock kind of guy. If we need to look at things, we'll take a look at it, which is awesome to have that help, that experience as we move forward. And Rick, if you want to go ahead to that next slide. Maybe. There we go. As I said, new director of agronomy, Mark Soto. Mark is actually going to start next Monday, the 16th. Mark had been a Troon associate years past, so knows Troon standards, Troon's expectations, leads his agronomic teams with a hands-on approach. He will be there with them, spend many hours with them. He's a yes person. He wants to make sure that we provide you the best possible conditions all the time. Mark is also a native Tucsonan. So as we were talking here earlier with David, I forgot that Mark has international experience. Mark was with Troon, headed off to, I believe it was Honduras, right? Did coursework there and then came back to the States with time in Texas and then came back here to Tucson. And currently wrapping up his responsibilities over at the Gallery Golf Club. Wayne Clark, he's going to start again October 1st. Years of leadership with Troon. He's been a head professional, a director of golf, general manager. He's worked for HOAs, so he understands the dynamic that we have here at Mountain View and Preserve. And as I said, we've got the still looking for those assistant professionals. And yes, I'm trying to get a lady professional. Want to make sure that I get that one through. We got to just have the ladies apply and, you know, make sure we find our best possible candidates. And Rick, let's go ahead there. So again, continuing to new in 24-25, with having a full professional staff, we are going to start really building our player development programs. From Get Golf Ready, which is our entry-level programs for those of you that are beginners, maybe never played, have an opportunity to maybe you stop playing for a while and want to come back and play. We've got those, so it's a group format. $125, five lessons, and then you're with like-minded, like-situation people. We're going to introduce golf schools. 3-4-day schools, 3-4 hours a day. Really hone your skills. To, you know, touch base everywhere, but we really get to dive in deep to your abilities and where you need to go and to improve your game. We had $5 Fridays. Everybody saw inflation. It's now $10 Thursdays. Okay. Now we'll probably go back to $5 Fridays as well, but had to just have some fun with that one. And then our popular sip and swing. We're going to continue that moving forward on both practice, more than likely here at Mountain View, more times than not. But that's always been a really, really popular event. Minimal cost, few swings, few sips, take some of the edge off, enjoy time with friends and family. Also, our social events. Anybody play in the Mountain View Masters Par 3 tournament last year? Okay, a handful of you. So what we did is we had a Par 3 tournament the Wednesday of the Masters Par 3 tournament at Mountain View. Was hoping for 36, maybe 40 people. We had 72. So it really told us, or told me in that case, that the social side is what people really want to do with their golf. We have plenty of opportunities to compete with our associations, but this was just a fun way of get together, have some fun, little pimento cheese sandwiches afterward. It was a lot of fun. Couples events. Who misses our couples events? I know Miss Erickson does, but we're going to bring those back, but in a little different format. We're going to have some Friday date nights or Friday date afternoons where we're going to be able to just pair up with a couple, with another couple, go out, play nine holes. We'll have dinner afterward. Sunday fun day. That's exactly what it sounds like. Go out, play golf with people you want to, have a little fun, make a few dollars, and then come on back in. Then we're going to do a Saturday shop game. Who's been a member of a private club before? Quite a few. Shop run events, you know, $5, $10 into the pot, turn around one best ball of two, you can pick your partner, you can continue to play in the groups you want to, not really a formal tournament, it's tee times, again, low key, have a lot of fun doing it. And, Rick, let's go ahead to the next one, the moment you've all been waiting for, the proposed programs for 2025. And it's such a big screen that you can't even see the whole thing. That's awesome. Annual pass holder. We really wanted to be competitive with our neighbors next door. So our annual pass holder is going to be $4,200 per person. Which if you remember, last year was $4,400. Less discounts brought it into $4,187. If you paid, if you're an annual, the loyalty discount and check. So we... We really haven't moved it too much, right? We've actually come down just a little bit. The next bullet point that's really, really key, 14-day advance booking on four tees. You will be on the tee sheet 14 days before your tee time, before the day you want to play. Where are we right now? Just 5 days. So you'll be on 9 days earlier than where you've been. Golf shop discounts, continue the 20%, 10%. Discounted range balls, as Matt had said earlier, access to Trune Advantage. And those of you that are not annuals right now, we will continue to add November and December at no additional cost. It's 14 months for the price of 12. One new one that we did this year is our seasonal unlimited plan. For those of you, if you're watching, hi, good to see you. January through April, and then November and December. So 6 months, $3,500 per person on that one. Same benefits, 14 days in advance. Jump down to our afternoon annual. That is $3,300. You'll get 10 days advance booking. So again, it's much, much earlier booking and on the tee sheet, much earlier than where we've been at. Resident rate, so if you're just regular pay-as-you-go, you'll be on the T-sheet 7 days in advance. We'll talk about the daily fee here in just a second. And then new to this year is our Saddlebrook Canyon card. That card is $125 per person, or I'm sorry, $129 per person. Complimentary round the day you purchase. We'll give you four free buckets of balls, and then this is the key, $10 off your green fee every time you play for 18 holes, $7 off for our 9 holes. So the more you play, the more you save. But on that one, lowest rate that we're going to offer, so it's 5 days advance booking on that one. Also, as Matt had mentioned, you have Trune Rewards, so you're automatically enrolled into Trune Rewards, which is going to offer you the opportunity to earn free golf. You can utilize it either here, Mountain View Preserve, or any one of the other Trune properties that are enrolled in the Trune Rewards program. And Rick, last one, I believe. Okay, so little bit of change on the pay-as-you-go. Rates for the winter are $72. So if you are that Canyon card holder, that's going to be down to $62. Our nine-hole rate, $46. And the twilight time will float depending on sunset times. So right now it's been static at 2 p.m., but we're going to just float that just a little bit. On that one, summertime, middle of May to the end of September, $49. And then we're back to our winter months back in October. Practice balls, $7 a bucket. The annual pass holders, you'll still get them for $5. Different thing this year as well, at the end of 2025, the range cards will reset. So if you have a range card, practice a lot in October, November, December. Because at the end, we're going to reset those back to zero. We're going to come up with Callaway rental clubs. We're in the process of getting those. So those will be nice, high-quality practice or rental clubs. And $50 a set includes a nice little valuables pouch, 6 golf balls included there. Rental cars went up $1, 15 for 9 holes and 22 for 18 holes. And then again, there's just that tee time booking window. We'll get this information out to you as well. I know it's a lot of information on the screen to try to comprehend, but we'll get that out there to you. And then I'll wait for questions until Lee says it's time for questions. And with that, I'm going to pass along to, I believe, Mr. Dan Liniger on that one.
Thank you, Mike. I'll remind everyone, from a board perspective, these rates will be approved, voted on, at the September board meeting. So as Mike mentioned, these are proposed. This is what Troon has put together so far. If you have comments, please let the golf committee or Mike know. But the official pricing and rate card will be available after the September board meeting, which I believe is 2 weeks from now. So this is just proposed information at this point in time. But I think I'm very excited about it. I really am very excited about it. Lots of changes, lots of improvements. And the reality for me is the 100 and some people that are playing all their golf at HOA1, we want you to come home. That's what we want. Come home. We got a great golf course. We've got pricing that is substantially more attractive than what you're paying. Come home. So I can't say that much more. So I'll end that conversation. Okay. I am not Ray Adams. You probably noticed that. I'm Dan Liniger, Vice President of the HOA2 Board. Ray is a member of our Finance Committee. He's also the chair of our Rules and Regulations Committee. Unfortunately, just before lunch, his wife, I can't describe exactly what happened to her, but she was taken to the hospital. So she is in the hospital. Ray is obviously there with her, and we wish her the very best. So I, at this moment in time, am going to try and be Ray Adams. And what I'm going to try and do for you is what Ray has put together, along with the Finance Committee, is a snapshot of what the reality of cash means to Troon and to us. We started off wanting to do a scorecard. We pay Troon money. I'd like to say, these gentlemen are here, they're free, they're wonderful people, they want the best for us. They're not free. Troon is here to make money as a corporation and provide a service. So I'm going to try to do what Ray had provided in terms of information and give you what is that cash view of the Troon relationship. Cash view of the Troon relationship is but one piece of it all. we have so much more in that relationship with regard to all the revenue growth strategies that Troon uses and employs to help us grow our revenue side. The support they give us in agronomy and construction is invaluable. But I want to talk about cash. What does it cost us to have Troon, and what do they do for us from a cash perspective? That was how Ray put this presentation together. So I will probably do a poor job, but I'll try to do the best I can as I tried to look at it very hard after lunch to make sure I understood it in some depth as Ray put it together. So we're going to look at a snapshot of 2023. 2024 is not over. We can't do a complete year review yet. There are still good things coming and have been coming since the Mountain View opening the 1st of June. So 2024 is not here to look at. 2023 is done, and we'll look at 2023. I will remind you, in 2023, we closed the Mountain View Golf Course May 1 for the balance of the year. We started the final, we started the back nine, I think it was October 9-ish, is when we opened the back nine up for play. We knew that when we put the budget together. We knew revenue was not going to be as it had normally had been. So this is a reality. The subsidy in 2023 was $904,000. Big number. The budget was over $1.1 million in subsidy because of that Mountain View closure. That's a reality. It's in our numbers. Next slide, please. Troon came on board, I think Lee did a good job of history. Troon came on board July 1, 2023. So they really only had 6 months of 2023. We had been enjoying good work from Club Car and Invited up until that point in time, but I think our work accelerated when the Troon folks came on board. Next slide. The analysis is not a financial, I'm doing this for Ray, the analysis is not a financial document, it's a rationalization of costs and benefits done by the finance committee, not done by Dan, not done by the board, done by the finance committee, who has a lot of people with good 10 key skills that can add and subtract numbers. Next slide. Okay, the actual golf net income in 2023 was better than budget. And you saw that 900 number. I told you the budget was 1.1-ish numbers by $217,000. The contract we have with Club Car, then Invited, and now Troon is an industry standard contract. And part of their reward for doing better than the budget that they establish with the owners of the golf course, whoever those people are, we now are that contract holder with Troon. They establish a reward of 15 cents on the dollar for everything that they improve beyond the budget. So that $210,000, they were paid a check, I think, of $33,000 for that improvement from budget that was agreed upon and voted on by the board in 2023. Next slide, please. Okay, so what's included in net income? It's going to mean something to you here in a minute, so I'll try to go through this. All the money golfers pay to play, revenue, that's what's included. All the costs, the operating costs of the front-end side of the business, which is the pro shops, the head pro, all of that kind of work, as well as the back-end side, I'll call it, which is the maintenance side. All those costs are included, including the cost of golf management team. There's a cost to Troon. We'll go through that in just a second. And any savings from Troon purchasing power for some things we used to buy on our own. Well, everything we bought on our own until we had a contract starting in 2022 with Club Car. We always assumed that we got some discounts because of Robeson, from what we understand in the world of Toro and many other vendors, that really wasn't true. We were standalone golf operation buying basically at MSRP. That's a reality. You don't have any leverage when you're a two golf operation to any great degree. Okay, so that's what's included in net income. Next thing. This is what we paid Troon in 2023. We pay them $10,000 a month to manage two golf courses. We have a payroll processing. They have the employees. The employees are theirs. They pay the employees. We end up getting the bill for the employees, but they pay them. They're Troon employees. We had some travel. That travel is going to go away because the invited crowd came out of Dallas. That's where Invited's headquarters was. Troon's up the road. When Matt comes down, I don't know what he does. I think he hitchhikes. He really does. He doesn't spend money. He's very frugal. But that number will come down dramatically. So the total we wrote a check for, the payroll processing fee is a questionable item, I think, because we would, if those employees were ours, if the six, the I can't remember exactly the number, but if those employees were our employees, we'd have had a payroll processing fee as well. So anyway, it is what it is. This is what Ray put together. $174 is what we paid Troon. That's for their management fee. They paid for employees. They paid a lot of other bills that we paid, but this is their above and beyond that we would not have paid. Okay, next slide. Use of Troon's personnel. What's not included in all of that? Their purchasing power. Matt alluded to that. They have a variety of contracts, national contracts with big suppliers. We take advantage of that. Chemicals and irrigation parts for our CAM group. They use the Troon contract. F&B uses Troon's discounts for our restaurant supplies. And food, big deal, Cisco. Cisco's a huge supplier. We get to use the Troon discount vendor program for food at no extra cost to our contract. That was not included in the club car contract in 2022. Troon said, hey, you guys use it. We appreciate the fact that they're allowing us to do that. These items saved us. They're not hugely significant, but they are money, $37,000 in 2023. Next slide. Although not required, I just mentioned this to you, the Troon purchasing and F&B, if Alan was here, Alan Lambert was here, he'd tell you, they really have enjoyed this contract because it's opened up new opportunities of savings for our F&B group because of these contracts. In the last 6 months of 2023, the year we're talking about, they saved $30,000. Now you think about $30,000, oh my goodness, we spend so much money. The margins in food are very slim. The margins are not significantly high to suggest that you're going to save millions and millions. So $30,000, big number. Next slide. We get roughly 10% off of all the bulk items that we buy, fertilizer, seed, chemicals. These are not small little purchases. We spend a lot of money. Golf courses spend a lot of money. It's not just us, but golf courses. Shop maintenance, shop merchandise, contracts with people like Johnny O, FootJoy, name a name. Better than we would ever buy on our own. 12% off of equipment. Toro, huge supplier for us. We buy a variety of other names. Typically every year we're replacing a piece of equipment that's worn out. And when we do that, we use the Troon contract. The same is true for CAM. The same is true for any of the facilities group within HOA2. They use the Troon contracts where available to them. So we try to maximize those discounts. Next slide. All of that added up to about $76,000 is what those numbers related to. And that's really pretty much over the second half of 2023. The other big deal, Troon has an advantage in the burden rates for their employees. Burden rates, if you're a business person, you know that that's health insurance, dental insurance, it's all kinds of benefits that employees receive to work for a company. Their benefits are less costly than the benefits that we employ here for HOA2, because we're in a very unique market here in terms of attracting people. So it's very difficult to put apples for apples in that. But we enjoy a big benefit for having been associated to Troon since July of 2023. That amounted to $123,000, that differential. Okay, next slide. So what's all this add up to? You remember the subsidy? We talked about that being $217,000 under. What I just described in all of these savings areas is, while that got to be 217, those discounts, those burden rates, all of that added up to the 217. We had other savings. So the bottom line is we saved about $254,000, and we wrote a check for about $175,000. That's the difference. So it's not huge. It's not $1 million, but it's plus. It's plus about $75,000. So we didn't have cash to pay for these gentlemen to stand here and help us throughout the year managing our golf operation. They provided us opportunities to save their cost by all the things I just described. Now, I have a few more slides. I won't go through them because that was a little bit of an early look of 2024. I will tell you that this presentation, and hopefully others as well, when we send out the video for you to listen to at home, if you want to listen to it again, which I would really enjoy doing, I'll do that when I get home, these presentations will be attached, so you'll be able to actually see them again. And if you have questions about them, you can call the Finance Committee, let Ray know, or I can get those questions to him. But I want to thank you very much for taking time to listen to this. This is another piece of the relationship we have with Troon. Very important piece, because it's the money piece. And as I said earlier, it doesn't take into account all of the other factors that are a part of that management contract. The revenue growth piece in golf is critical. I've told people many times, you cannot save your way to heaven. You have to grow your business. And that's where Troon comes into play significantly for us. So anyway, thank you very much. I'll turn it back to you, Lee. I think it's you, Lee.
That's fine. It's David Stout coming on now, the Troon agronomist.
Good afternoon. My name is David Stout. I'm a regional director of science and agronomy for Troon. I live right here in Tucson myself. I have worked for Troon for nearly 24 years. The bulk of it's here in Tucson. I spent a few years in Scottsdale, but the majority of my career path was at La Paloma. I was a golf course superintendent there for nearly 13 years, and then the club's general manager for 5 years before I accepted this role here about 2.5 years ago. So very happy to be a part of seeing Saddlebrook move forward, and it's already been very rewarding. One of the questions I'm asked a lot is, how does Troon Agronomy support our superintendents in the field or our individual properties? The bulk of my responsibility is I conduct site visits. I go to different golf courses. I usually drive around with the superintendent, get to know them, see what's working for them, what's not, what's their relationship like with committees, boards, general managers, what's their situation? And then I follow that up with the general manager or board to see, are they happy with conditions? Is there anything they want to see change? And then we kind of formulate a plan. I'll generate a site report that just goes over what we looked at that day. it's not a punch list. It's not a list of things for a superintendent to do, because that's not the best use of our time. We look at themes, we look at things high level, and we try to drive or influence behavior and change rather than give a detailed list of things to check off, because if that's the case, then they're not the superintendent anymore. Other items that we do is we help develop staff guidelines. This is usually in conjunction with finance committees. We take a look at staff guidelines. I'm really big into agronomic planning. I think your agronomic plan essentially underwrites your budget. And that plan should just be an itemized list of things, themes that we want to accomplish in a calendar format. So a board, a committee, the golf staff, a general manager, they can look at that and make sure that that works with play. There's a give and a take between the agronomy team and the operations. Every superintendent would love to close their golf course in Arizona from basically June 1 to November 1. It's not a reality. And I think every operations leader would love to have no maintenance done on the golf course between November 1 and May 1. Also not a reality. So we kind of go back and forth, and we make sure that whatever we do is the best thing for the operation. We do a lot of testing. You know, we collect a lot of data. We look at our water. We look at our soil. We look at the physical performance of our greens, bunkers, tees, fairways, to make sure what we have is workable. And we'll get into that a little bit when we talk about the preserve. We also look at developing our team. So when I go to different facilities, I try to speak to folks and figure out where do they want to be in life. We might find that young assistant that's working in northern Washington that wants to go to China or to wherever. And we try to help that happen for those folks and provide the best people at every facility that we work with. Yes, please. So this is our exciting organizational structure here. So I'm down there underneath Dave Nichols here on the bottom row of many folks. There's about it's about 15 of us that support our courses, both here domestically and internationally. I work with the West Coast. I work with courses from Bellingham, Washington, down through Oregon, California, into southern Arizona. So this is the farthest north that I go in Arizona. I don't go up to Phoenix. I'm just here in Tucson and over to the eastern half of Arizona. It's a lot of words here, but I'll just kind of sum it up in saying agronomy's changed. The industry has changed. We still have a significant labor shortage. This is both hourly associates who we would hire to mow greens and rake bunkers, up to and including superintendents. It's taking around 60 days to fill an assistant superintendent position, and around 70 days is what it's taken me to fill a superintendent or a director of agronomy position. There's not a lot of those folks out there, and there's a few reasons why. I grew up in rural Pennsylvania. I went to Penn State, one of the biggest agricultural schools in the country. I worked on a golf course as a teenager, and I had that pathway. Whereas now a lot of facilities, particularly in the state of California, they can't hire minors. So if you're a 17 or 18-year-old high school student in an urban environment, you're not going to go to an agricultural school for agronomy or soil science like I did. And furthermore, even the agricultural schools are suffering. The University of Arizona, their turf and crop production program, it essentially shut down when Dr. Kopeck retired here a few years ago. So similar to us in the field, in academia, there's not a lot of desire for young folks to get into College of Agricultural Sciences. So we're kind of at a point of inflection where we really need to reinvest back into those programs and those folks, or we're going to be in a huge shortage of people in the future for leadership. So we work with programs like the FFA, 4-H, the GCSAA has a really good program called First Green, where they do volunteer field trips to different facilities. We did one at La Paloma about 2 months ago, and had around 36 youngsters from mainly Yuma and Casa Grande come in, and that was really well received. Other items we have here, supply chain issues still exist for golf course maintenance. We are still seeing around a 12 to an 18 month delivery time in golf course maintenance equipment. So if we buy a fairway unit today, it could be 12 to 18 months before it's delivered to property, which is insane. But I firmly believe Toro and John Deere have done a really good job managing their inventory and not letting it stack up like we've seen with some other businesses. Lastly, we'll touch on some increased regulatory pressure. This comes in all forms. I work with the state of California on this, and regulations are plentiful, and they're not going to get less with each legislative cycle, as you could imagine. And a lot of those regulatory pressures and water reductions will help drive what ends up happening on the preserve golf course in the future. So we'll jump into that. So the Preserve Golf Club, you know, we want to look at this from basically an asset perspective. So we've got this golf course. It was built in 2004. It's 20 years old. All things reach an end of a life cycle, and we're approaching that with the golf course. We've got tees out there that are a little less than level. We've got TIF dwarf greens, which haven't been planted on a new golf course since approximately 2004. Got a 21-year-old pump station that's put out around 2 billion gallons of water in its lifetime, if not more. The irrigation system is made of PVC. We haven't installed a PVC-based irrigation system in a number of years. Everything is now HDPE. And after years of all the different cycles through it, there's fatigue. Irrigation technology has improved dramatically. Back when the preserve was built, we used irrigation heads that threw about 70, 75 feet. Now we use more heads and closer together, so we get more precision with where we water and how we water. 75 feet is quite a big distance with our, you know, afternoon southwest winds to contend with. Turf reduction. State of Arizona has, they will launch their fifth management plan, and this is essentially regulation that allots water to different golf courses. It's designed to conserve groundwater. Golf courses in Arizona use a very small portion of groundwater compared to other commercial, industrial, or agricultural uses. We use quite a bit of reclaimed water. Here at the preserve in Mountain View, we use reclaimed water as well. But the fifth management plan is more aggressive than the fourth, third, second, and first. So turf grass reduction will be a necessity as we go forward. That's a lot of what drove the Mountain View project, was making sure that we reduced our turf grass so we can be sure to hit our allotment, because the last thing you want to do is run into November 13th and be told you're over allotment. And I can tell you right now that has happened at facilities in Phoenix. We manage the Phoenician, and there were times they had to water tees, landing areas, and fairways and greens, and that was it. That's one of the driving reasons why Phoenician is now an 18-hole facility, because their water bill was a hurdle. It was a big roadblock. Maintenance costs, bunkers. When we look at the preserve, I don't think any of us in this room would say that those bunkers are fantastic. There's too many. They're too big. They're too severe. A lot of what we do is we collect data, and we can say with a reasonable high amount of assurity that bunkers take up more time, energy, resources, and therefore dollars, than even greens do, even bankgrass greens. We use a lot of software, labor tracking programs, and we can back this up all the time. So anytime we look at a bunker project, we should really question, how many bunkers can we get rid of? Why are they there? Do they need to be that big? Do they need to be that severe? When the preserve golf course was built, it was built during an era when bunker sand was $20 a ton. Labor in Tucson in 2004 was probably $6 an hour for golf course maintenance. We're paying about $22 for a golf cart tire. So the entire economics of golf courses today are different. We would never build the preserve over again this way. We wouldn't do it. So our challenge to any architect would be, how many bunkers can we remove without sacrificing the experience and playability of the golf course? And I think that's the biggest challenge that whoever would be selected to do the golf course design for the preserve, that would be one of their biggest tasks, is how do we rethink these spaces? We've all played number four and number six, and you see these 60-degree slopes. There's not a sand on the earth that can defy physics. It's always going to fall down that slope. And then each rain event we get, that native material mixes with it. And the next thing we know, we've made low-grade concrete in the base of our bunkers. And there's no amount of sand we can keep throwing on top of that to make it work. So we're definitely overdue from the bunker renovation standpoint. We're ready to go there. So a lot of numbers here.
Hey, David, can I take just a second to give a bit of an introduction to this?
Please.
Is that okay? What David's going to talk about now is a very important topic for the budget process that we're currently going through for 2025. The board is putting together a 5-year and a 10-year plan, a budget plan, a fiscal financial plan going forward 5 and 10 years. Within that time frame, we all understand it, we've talked about it enormously, the Preserve Golf Course needs work and attention. So somewhere along the line, we've got to put numbers in a box in a year. That's part of the board's responsibility. The Finance Committee, the Golf Committee, a lot of people, and Troon, have input into that decision process. Troon is considered an expert. As you know, the board, if it doesn't know what it doesn't know, which is a lot, we need to rely on experts. We hire lawyers to rely on experts. We hire accounting firms to rely on experts. Troon is an expert. So we've asked Troon, hey, how would you renovate our golf course at the Preserve? How would you do it? Over what periods of time? Tell us what that might look like financially so we can have an idea about what to do with this 2025 through 2029 budget process and 5 years beyond. That's a bit of an introduction for this. So I just wanted to do that before. You got a lot of numbers. You're going to go into a lot of good detail here. So I just wanted to give you an introduction.
Still a lot of numbers. So all of these numbers they're generated from real projects that we work with. So we have two folks in our office, Ron Despain and Jeff Poling. All they do is construction. They work with different facilities all over the world. These numbers are generated from projects we've done here in the Southwest. So, Colorado, Utah, Arizona, Texas. So with the high degree of accuracy, we feel good about putting these up here based on the square footage or some of the other areas that are on the Preserve course. So there's a number of ways to do this. We can perform all of the construction in the shortest amount of time and be done with it. Or we can draw it out throughout different years to try to be sensitive to an outlay of cash. My personal observation and experience is that the quicker you can get the construction done, it does a few things for you. The intangible is the construction fatigue of having a golf course closed for 2, 3, 4 years. It just wears on folks. You never feel like it's done. The expenses will escalate higher than what you can adjust rate for. There's no doubt about it. You cannot accelerate your rate until your project is done. So if it takes you 2, 3, 4 years to do this, the smartest FP&A folks would have this laid out for us in a model, but your rate wouldn't capture your expenses, and therefore your return on that invested capital would be less. So ultimately, it is my recommendation for those specific reasons, from both fatigue and from an expense standpoint and a revenue generation standpoint, is to try to shorten that window as much as you can. Then the other intangible, which is more of a reality today than before, is even though golf is in demand, and we've certainly benefited from COVID, the amount of golf construction companies are few and far between. 2008 to 2011 financial crisis took them out. and very few folks have tried to fill that space. It's a very capital intensive space. If you're doing one project, you're not somewhere else until you scale up, and the risk of scaling and not yielding back is huge. So as we draw out a timeline for construction, that's another factor. Because if you're a construction company, you're going to pick and therefore bid jobs based on the best potential margin. In a 4-year construction process would not be as attractive to a construction company. So you're going to pay a premium because they're going to have to give up some other job in order to do a smaller, you know, scale job. Because again, these folks, there's only so big they can scale before they have to hit the next level and the next level, and therefore they have to really be careful with how they estimate and they bid. So all that said and done, you know, the few assumptions here are, if you look down at the bottom, there's a cost escalation based on 4%. I'll be the first person to raise my hand and say, when I model, I have a conservative bias. You're not supposed to, but I can't help myself. I think 4%'s a little low, based on all the reasons I stated earlier. I feel that number is closer to 6, but for the purpose of this exercise, we left it at 4. And as you can see, the total financial impact of drawing this out, it's about $1 million in difference. And I more than strongly suspect you can't make that back in rate, and it would just be fatiguing for any of us in the room that want to use the facility. I think that would just draw out to the point where you would feel like it's never done. It would be less impactful, is what I'm getting at. Next slide. That's it. That's a lot of material. I'm sure there has to be a question or two.
David, Lee, what do you want to do on question? You want to open it up to the floor?
Well, we are at the question and answer portion of this time right now. Thanks a lot for that, David. Again, this will be out there for people to look at. What the board and the golf committee, and the golf committee for the board, really wanted to get this out to you to get feedback so that we could help with this. We're just at the very beginning stage of deciding what we want to do, what we need to do, what we're willing to do, all of those sorts of things. So please contact the golf committee. We have I wish I had the website on the top of my head, but I don't. You can contact that. Or right now, stand up and ask some questions if you're so inclined.
I think
earlier you mentioned that Troon is awarded a 15% portion of savings under expected budget as part of their contract or in addition to
That's right.
I assume that in the budgeting process, there are contingency numbers that are put in there. Do they participate in everything? Is that savings determined by that total number, including your contingency figures?
I don't know about contingencies. There's no line item in our budget for contingencies that I know of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Second question is, does Troon have the expertise to offer to you, I guess this is a question for Troon, do they feel they have the expertise to recommend to the board how you go about getting this budget approved by a community that seems to be pretty dramatically split between people that feel that the golf courses are an essential part of Saddlebrook living and those that think it's of no use?
I'll take that if I can. Real quickly, it's a great question. It's obvious that's the world we're living in. I think right now, and I can't speak for the whole board, I'm just one person, what we're really trying to understand is what the best way forward is from a planning perspective, knowing that something has to be done. And how you do it, we're just trying to get some expert advice. I wouldn't think the board would rely on Troon for how do I go get the money part. That's a different discussion between certainly the board, the residents, the finance committee, and all of that. So I don't know if that answers your question, but I think we're relying on them for the mechanics and the best recommendations on how you would do this project as a foundation for planning financially to how do you do this project. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay, that's as best. Matt, would you say anything different than that? Okay, so like I said, I'm one of seven. I am not, sometimes I'm smart and sometimes I'm not. So hopefully I'm a little smart on this one.
I will say also though, the one interesting thing about Troon and our Troon team here is that both Matt and David have GM experience. So they understand that there's a political dynamic here and they're here to help us navigate that with information. And I think that's very helpful.
Should be on. We'll see.
Hello? Is it on? Oh, how about that? Hey, I want to back up to the rate sheet. I had made a suggestion to the Gulf Committee a while back on how to handle new residents. One of our problems is that too many of our people are playing in one. It would be real helpful if we could suck those new people in to playing at HOA 2 by virtue of giving them a annual pass at a prorated rate. And I'm not sure why that wasn't considered, whether it was considered. I would give them, I mean, you can play with this. Do they do it within 30 days or 60 days of moving there? Some time frame like that.
Mike says yes. I think Duff, the Golf Committee, I think in the past has always been receptive to annualizing or prorating the rest of the year. I think, right, Mike? So if you moved in June and you wanted to become an annual, he'd work with you on that regard. Is that right?
100%. I'd like to take it a step further and make sure that every new resident's aware of that as part of their introduction to Saddlebrook.
We have a packet that the Golf Committee puts in every mailbox. We get all the new homeowners. They get a packet. We have a golf and play thing where one of the committee members or we'll find somebody to play with you, free lunch, Mike comes over and talks afterwards. We're working very hard to make sure that every new resident finds out as much as there is about golf.
Thank you.
Me again, Steve Wiley. I came here mostly to learn. Here I am popping off. So one question, I think it gets back to the gentleman talking about contingency, and I think my interpretation is what he is getting at is there's anybody that's been in and around budget compilation or working with them knows that there's squish in budgets. There just is, right? So I think what the contingency question is, we don't want to pay people for squish. So my question is simply, who does the budgeting? Is it Troon?
We work with the board on it. It has to be board approved.
So it's a combined effort. There's an innate conflict of interest there that I think the gentleman was getting at. I'll just reiterate that. Secondly, you seem pretty astute financially and modeling and that sort of thing. I'm looking for somebody I can work with on this, on modeling in general, in what we do in the board, and maybe I could get your contact information and discuss that. I mean, you're talking about the near term and doing it all at once and getting that. As you know, there's a ton of scenarios in there on how you approach it. And for example, and I'm gonna be a little ridiculous here, but I could ask, how many times have we actually replaced PVC in the irrigation system in the last X amount of years? What's that number? Maybe leave it alone and just replace the heads, for an example. That's an example. I'm not knowledgeable in, like you are, in golf course maintenance and so on, but there's a whole bunch of scenarios that can influence how you approach it, how you model it. And then my particular little bug in my bonnet is, anytime you talk inflating numbers, you've also got to, in theory and in practice actually, you've got to discount those back.
That's right.
To some present number, which we don't typically do here, I'm learning. So those are the kind of discussions I'd like to engage with you on.
Yeah, so we'll start there. So I think, you know, irrigation and golf course renovation projects, you know, they're not a standard NPV or an IRR model because there's infrastructure there. So we're replacing a lot of infrastructure. So if this was a, you know, strictly a revenue generation thing, like do we build a second golf course or third golf course? You know, we would model that out. We would have a very robust NPV. We'd figure out our IRR. We'd say this checks out. You know, it exceeds zero, we move, or it doesn't, and we're done. It dies right there on paper. But so much of what we're talking about here with irrigation, it's no different than a roof. It's no different than the asphalt. Obviously, a better irrigation system, you'd have better conditions, and in theory, that can yield rate. But a lot of this is end of lifespan. You know, PVC is about 25-year lifespan. Here we are. You know, Ventana Canyon just replaced the canyon's irrigation system. They've got mountain to do. I think I got that right. La Paloma has been in a few different phases of that. Their PVC-based irrigation system turns 40 this year. And, you know, they spend upwards of $50,000 a year on irrigation repairs. It's a huge task. Backing up to the budget, the budget creation should not be done in a vacuum. It should be done in a way where the initial portion of the budget is always going to be finding the model, right? The business model. Our target, you know, do we want to break even? Where do we want to land as far as our performance goes? And that kind of sets the tone for the operation. So revenues are generally done first with a target, and then expenses are done. From the golf course maintenance perspective, I make it mandatory that all of our directors of agronomy or superintendents, they have an agronomic plan. So for example, if we're going to top dress greens twice a month, during the growing season here, hopefully, that is April 1 through October 1. So that's, you know, 8 months, you know, we should have 16 top dressing events. And if we know we're gonna put out 25 tons of sand per top dressing event, that's 50 tons. And if it costs us $100 a ton, we know our total input. So if it costs, say, $5,000 a month for sand, using that example, that's the number we budget. We don't budget 7,500, we don't budget four, we budget the number. One thing that's not up here is the discounts that we have are through our partners like Syngenta, Simplot, Harrells. They also do early order programming. So Mark, when he arrives, he will take a whole scale, fresh look at the operation, and he will order the bulk of 2025's products in October. And Syngenta and Simplot and those other chemical companies, they give us 6 months, 8 month terms. So we don't have to pay in full until June. So we borrow their money to do so. All of those discounts go back to this property. They come back in the form of a check, which Mike can then take and put it against that GL line as a credit, or it can be taken, hopefully not, as general revenue. It's up to the course's discretion what they do with that. But ultimately, what should happen, again, is the initial portion of the budget kind of drives where the business goes, and that's how we set up. Do we need additional staff? Do we need to, how do we scale our services, or what do we do? And then the expense budget comes second, and that has to meet the overall, has to meet the mission statement of this particular property. So I think you're right to question everything. I get it. But there are a number of checks and balances, so there's not a thumb on the scale here.
Conversation here, but are you an ongoing person involved here?
Yes.
Okay, I'll just get your contact info. And
yeah, and as a point of clarification, I believe the incentive fee is not just expenses, it's NOI, so it's revenues less expenses.
Good presentation, guys. My question is there any meaningful alternative to the winter grass overseeding? Seems very disruptive on an ongoing basis to our business or any golf course's business.
That's a great question. Asked every year around this time. Unfortunately, we live in the desert Southwest where arbor meadow grass doesn't last all. It's not actively growing year round, particularly here at this elevation. We tried at a number of different facilities to not overseed, and we've actually brought back overseeding at a number of those just due to overall playability conditions and kind of general perception. I'm with you. If we could get to the point where we didn't have to overseed, sign me up. Right now, there are a number of trials that are happening with different styles of Bermuda grass, so for, this is exciting to me. But for those of you who might have come from the Midwest, you probably have had zoysia grass lawns or played on zoysia golf courses. Zoysia grass is starting to come west. There's actually a number of golf courses in Scottsdale that are trialing zoysia grass as an alternative to Bermuda grass. And then ironically, in the Midwest, Bermuda grass is moving that way. So in St. Louis, which was the king of zoysia grass, they're now planting Bermuda grass. I work with a facility in Northern California. They are experimenting it, but they're finding it's pretty prone to disease. So spraying fairways is not in their wish list. But to your point, if we could find an alternative, you've got this stage would be in support of it. Day one, we would jump in with both feet if we could do it. And we do at some other facilities too. We skipped overseed in the city of Tucson courses. We were rotating one course that didn't overseed because the Bermuda grass coverage was thin at those facilities for a number of years. And we would use some of these newer pigments or dyes. And that's pretty good. If we were at even Phoenix's elevation, that would probably be more successful. But we're quite cold here at this elevation, just too much traffic.
Hello, I'm Jerry Gustafson from Unit 50. My first comment would be when we hire an architect, I think it would be nice if it was made clear to him that a lot of residents think we don't need maybe a PGA course, that what we need is a nice retirement community, golf courses. Second point is there's three items that were a bit distressing to me. That cost $1.5 million each, both it looked like in the Mountain View actual and that are in the reserve study. One is the driving range. $1.5 million for a driving range that looked fine to me, and a preserve one looks fine to me right now. Second one is the leveling the tee boxes is a whole lot of money for a guy who golfed for 15 years, and I assure you I wouldn't know the difference if a tee box was 5 degrees off from level. And I also would think that some of that could be done by the staff. Third one is a turf reduction, which is a great idea and is mandated, but I think a lot of that could be done by existing staff also. Thank you.
Let me ask real quick. You mentioned how much for a driving range? Maybe I misunderstood you.
I thought I saw $1.5 million in there for Mountain View actual, and a million and a half for the preserve reserve study.
I don't think there's anything close to that, but I don't know the exact number. But
I'll show you the reserve study.
Yeah, yeah. Go look at the reserve study. Okay.
Sorry. Hi, I had one question for you on Troon operation courses that you manage. You know, we know that the golf course has to be done. I'll get to the second part of that story in a minute. But my question is, in your operations procedures, if you managed 800 courses, what percent of them would close all at once? And what percent phase their work? Because I think it's a mixed bag, but tell us your statistics of operation as it exists now.
You're 100% right, it's a mixed bag. If you're at a 54-hole facility, it would behoove you to close one course per year, you'd have 36 in inventory, you'd be fine. If you're at an 18-hole course, that is in a temperate climate like Denver or Michigan, you might not want to close it because you would really lose quite a bit. It really depends on the structure of each facility. So it's there's really no one number. Out here in the Southwest, it's generally get the work done with so you can get back and get moving again. And that's usually the best financial pathway for each facility.
Because, you know, we dealt with losing members. We dealt with huge revenue loss for 6 months of the year this year. So, you know, we don't want to repeat that. So that needs to stay fresh in everyone's mind as we think about this. We're still in recovery mode from Mountain View. My second thing is a comment. Again, there's no anti-golf sentiment to the fact that the preserve needs to be done. But I sit on the facilities committee. And the CAM building needs replaced. And the Mountain View kitchen is too small. And the preserve kitchen is too small. And so when we hear McMahon Group talk to us about those facilities, they tell us the same thing. Cost escalation, renovation fatigue, everybody wants to come and do it all at once and stay. But we don't have the cash flow for that. So I think, again, as we're developing this budget, it's not in isolation. The golf course is 20 years old, but the community is 30. Okay, so that all has to, there has to be a sensitivity, because we don't want to get into a point where we have option 1, 2, 3 about golf only, because we know what happens. And if you look at the study that we did, the survey in 2023, these were the facts. I looked them up last night. Mountain View said 55% of the people said they had no interest at all. For the preserve golf course, 60% said they had no interest at all. So we have to just work this so that everything that's old gets fixed. It's a lot of money. It's probably $20 million across all facilities. So we have to be sensitive to that, and it may influence us. We're going to pay more because we can't do everything in 1 year. That's a fact.
Agreed.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's suggesting everything in 1 year by any stretch. All right.
Hi, good afternoon. I guess I have a question that's come up in the first RRF meeting. Our president basically said, and he means well, but he said, we will not consider selling a golf course. The preserve would make the most sense because we just renovated one. So if you look at the amount of money that we need for just golf reserves compared to the whole, it's really out of balance. And it's, I do believe golf has value. I think that before we bought the golf courses, the golfers still golfed. If, and I believe the idea of looking at selling the preserve is a valid idea that should be investigated. The only thing we lose is control, but if you could find a buyer, you could put covenants in it that would protect our interests going forward. Now, I just looked briefly. I was actually looking at Troon to see if Troon buys golf courses, and it didn't seem that you do. It looked like to me you manage golf courses. I found three companies that buy golf courses. I'm sure there's more. One was Invited. I think we should at least investigate the idea of that. Another one is Tiger Woods buys golf courses, his company. And then there's one great golfer that just sold six of his golf courses here to, I think, a company called ICIS, A-C-I-S. And they bought six golf courses in Arizona. So anyway, my question is this. I believe the community has a right to add, I believe you have a, you should ask the community if we should investigate this. And I'd like to know what your thoughts are on that.
I'd be happy to elaborate on that. I would start by saying that there is no one that has your best interests in mind more than this group, your HOA. No one, no other purchaser. Somebody could buy a golf course and they could find it doesn't work. Unfortunately, a lot of what I deal with is that. You find a buyer who gets a distressed golf course for $2 million and thinks they're the smartest guy in the room. And they dive into the financials and they do see that there is net income from the operation. It breaks even or it makes a dollar. And they can self-fund, kind of. But what it can't do is generate money for CapEx. And there is a slew of courses that are 15 to 25 years old that are all end of life. I mean, there's pump stations on 25 years, golf course maintenance equipment. I walk into these facilities almost monthly, and I'll get their financials in advance and I'll look at it. And I already know what I'm walking into before I get there, without the sound arrogant. But I can look at it, and it makes X for top line, and it flows a couple dollars at the bottom. And I walk into a maintenance facility and it needs $2.5 million of maintenance equipment, which, by the way, is not much anymore. That number sounds crazy, but it's a fairway unit's $100,000. You go into their pump station and a motor's off, and if you step on it, you're going to fall 15 feet into the well. All the bunkers are shot. The irrigation's 30 years old. The golf carts were bought out of a lease, so we paid a lease payment for 9 years straight. I firmly believe that the best interest for golf course communities is for the community to own the golf course. That is not a Troon statement. That is my personal statement. In fact, a lot of the distressed courses I see that are within communities, it's heartbreaking. The Palm Springs area has a number. If you drive up I-15 in San Diego, there's a number. If you go to New Mexico, there's a number of them. And it's instances where, I mean, even in their own community, I mean, you all saw what happened to Vistoso. You all saw what happened to Skyline, and you all saw what happened to Arizona National. And in certain circumstances, the HOA came in, they did a very difficult thing, a very selfless thing, and a number of those facilities are still operating today, and a number of them are not. So ultimately, that's a community decision, but that's my observation.
Thank you. That's it? Very good. Please reach out to the golf committee. You can go on our website, the HOA website, find it. With any further comments, look over that rate sheet. Please. We'd like comments on all this.
I can't walk up there because of my oxygen, but I do have a question. Can I get a mic? Or can you hear me?
I'll repeat it into the mic.
Wait.
Sorry, I just can't get up there with my oxygen tank. Right now, the preserve is playing quite well. The tee boxes seem to be very good. Are they perfect? I don't know. I'm like the other gentleman said. I don't If they're 5 degrees, 10 degrees off, I don't know. They're playing good for me. The greens seem to be very good right now, and I'm wondering why we can't put this off a little bit and so that the community can do other things that are needed to do to keep us a special assessments from the community. But why are the greens in such poor shape, and why are the tee boxes considered in such poor shape?
So the tee boxes themselves have an opportunity for turf removal. They're not an island. They've got that extra turf around there. And the tee boxes have an opportunity for turf removal themselves. So it would be remove the turf around them, level them, and then change either the orientation or the size based on the design. If no orientation or size needs addressed, it would be remove that ancillary, that kind of rough band of turf around it, and then just level the tee tops. The cost of that really is the new sod, because every golf course on Saddlebrook has about 3 acres of tee, so you're really buying 3 acres of sod. That's the main cost. It's not the leveling. The leveling itself at a scale is only a few pennies a foot. The greens themselves, the physical performance of the greens are beginning to suffer. So when JR, for those of you that know JR, when he irrigates at night, we're not getting much in there. Over 24 years, the organic matter is built up, plus Tift Wharf, the style of grass that's on there, it's not a modern grass. It plays better when it's overseeded than it does in the summer, because you can't really regulate it that much. If you notice, it kind of turns bronze after a growth regulator application. And JR has done a fantastic job. I have been thoroughly impressed. We also have a lot of 419, which is the Bermuda grass that's in the fairways, that's gotten into the greens over the years. So it's really a reset button, and it wouldn't be completely blowing them up and starting over. We'd strip the sod off, take 4 inches of sand out, because the testing that we did in December showed we didn't have to do a full rebuild, and we would put new sand in and regrass it that way. So to put it off, again, I'll use an example. You know, my time at La Paloma, it's a 40-year-old irrigation system. We had the contract signed in 2020. February of 2020, we were ready to go. And that was around $5 million to do all 27 holes. The need for that irrigation system didn't lessen in 4 years. The price has nearly doubled. And we waited, and they don't have an irrigation system. So your needs aren't going to get less over time. They're gonna remain exactly where they're at today or get worse. And again, the cost will escalate beyond a reasonable level, in my opinion, than what you could generate cash for minus special assessments.
Could you maintain them so that we can save the money?
I think they're being maintained quite well right now, but again, the need doesn't change. They need to be replaced. So we could squeeze them out another X number of years, which would make protecting the current rate for Mike and team a challenge. I think it would be very difficult to compete with the rest of the market or the rest of our competitive set. And I think there would be a number of folks who use the course and say, why aren't we doing this? So there's two sides to every equation. I appreciate where you're coming from. I think every effort should be maintained to look at how to use resources. And I'd leave you with this, just like your comment earlier. I don't think that there's any place out there whose available capital is greater than their needs. So I think it is a game of chess and how to use it and how to preserve it, how to grow it, how to be responsible with it. And we just want to be partners in that and help make sure that every dollar that's used is used correctly.
Amen. It's the golf committee's thing too. Well, if that's all the questions we have, I appreciate everybody coming. Please give us your feedback, and thank you so much to the Troon team for all this informative thing. Thanks.